people, if not all, hopefully have come back. And I wonder whether it's this one person in the room who has now close to a heart attack. If I put this up and say, who's that? No one? No, everybody has a... Has a
you must read something from each side.
I won't disclose who he is, but I know. Okay, with this being cleared, we can proceed in our program and finally actually get to those guys which have been already lurking in the background and have been part of the presentations and who are this piece in between content and consumer, or maybe they are not only piece in between, maybe they are also already on the content side. I'm talking about internet service providers and their liability, and it gives me a particular pleasure to introduce to you Judge Spano from the European Court of Human Rights, so next door, and he is extremely worth, and maybe the person who introduced to you the effects that our discussion of liability issues has on human rights. There were very prominent court cases concerning internet portals and bringing us to Estonia, where Mr. Ansip just left us, but I'm sure he will be also aware of these topics. And there has been a series of judgments and a later case where the judgment had a first way of being tested. And I think this is more already than I need to say, because the word is with Judge Spano, who will explain to you everything else. Please.
Thank you very much, Madam Chairperson. It is a great pleasure to be with you here today to discuss the case law of the European Court of Human Rights, which is, as you know, just across the street. I've been asked to discuss a very important and topical issue in European human rights case law and protection. It deals with an issue which is complex. We are dealing with an issue in a rapidly developing world which continue to challenge our conception of human rights. I think it's fair to say that the internet has had a transformative effect on all aspects of modern society, including the law. I've said in some conferences before that the internet is probably the most transformative invention in human history after the Industrial Revolution about 250 years ago, at least as regards human-to-human interaction, and also as regards the interaction between individuals and government. It is testing settled legal principles in basically all fields of law, and in the field of human rights, in particular as regards the right to privacy, the freedom of expression, and the right to property. And for those of you dealing with the IP issues, of course, are aware of that. I want in this context to talk about the recent case law of my court. There are two cases which have recently been delivered. A grand chamber case in a case called Delfi versus Estonia, and subsequent to that, a case from Hungary, MTE, which, as mentioned by the chairperson, is a follow-up case dealing with essentially similar type of factual elements as in Delfi. In these cases, the court for the first time had to formulate its conception of the principles that should apply when an assessment is made of the latitude the member states have under Article 10 of the Convention, which is the free speech provision, freedom of expression, which I will be talking about today, to impose liability on online intermediaries for unlawful comments posted on their websites by anonymous users. Just a couple of conceptual issues here. When we talk about freedom of expression in general, we talk about the interaction between a person who speaks or articulates an idea, a viewpoint, and a recipient of that view, which is the defamed person or the injured party, and that relationship has logically been the focus of existing legal principles. But what happens when there is an intermediary? There is somebody that disseminates or creates a platform for the dissemination of the speech from the speaker, the author, to the injured party. How do we deal with that under human rights principles? And in particular, how do we deal with that when we are trying to emphasize the efficacy and the benefits of the internet as a massive forum of ideas and thought dissemination? I'm going to proceed in two brief parts. Let me just tell you first a little bit about these judgments, the facts in these cases, and then say a few words about whether one may plausibly argue that a particular form of liability of content providers, internet service providers, is best compatible with Article 10 of the Convention, and maybe reflect a bit on the consequences that the two judgments may have on the court's decision-making in this sphere. Let me, before I talk about these judgments, add a bit to the broader context here. The court has said and emphasized that along with the internet's benefits, certain dangers may also arise. Not least, the court has highlighted the fact that defamatory statements and other types of clearly unlawful speech, hate speech, violent speech, can be disseminated like never before worldwide in a matter of seconds, and sometimes remain persistently online. In other words, difficult tensions arise on the internet between freedom of expression on the one hand and the right to privacy and personality rights, the right to a reputation, for example, on the other. The question that may be put in a theoretical perspective: how should the internet be regulated? Or should it be regulated at all? There are two diametrically opposing viewpoints here, and these viewpoints were introduced to us in the Strasbourg court by various third-party interveners in these cases. The first argues that the internet is of a sui generis nature. It is something we have never known before in human-to-human interaction, and its undoubted impact on human relations require that governments and even private stakeholders, such as online communication networks, refrain from any form of internet regulation. The internet should be a free state without borders. The second viewpoint, in contrast, argues that due to its special nature and impact, the internet cannot in fact be free from regulation. It must be regulated because of its potential harms. As will become apparent through my discussion of the case law, I think these first judgments suggest that the court, perhaps in a rather weak manner, but yes, it's treading ground, it's a pioneering force in this at the outset of the internet's development, is trying to find a middle ground. It's trying to find a middle ground between these opposing viewpoints, seeking to secure the beneficial impacts of the internet while at the same time safeguarding other fundamental convention rights, in particular the right to reputation and the right to privacy. As is often the case in the court's reasoning, balance is key. Let me now tell you a bit about Delfi versus Estonia. Here you have an online intermediary, Delfi, which is, I think, still the biggest sort of news website in Estonia. It published an article about a ferry company on its webpage discussing a particular decision taken by the company to change its ferry routes. The article itself was nothing spectacular. It wasn't sensationalizing anything. It was just a statement of a certain fact. Now, this article attracted offensive and even threatening comments which were later described by the Strasbourg court as hate speech and violent speech against the owner of this ferry company, the CEO of this ferry company. Now, these comments stayed online for 6 weeks, and then immediately upon the request of this person, the injured person, the comments were taken down by Delfi. Irrespective of that, he went to court, for compensation, received compensation at domestic level, Delfi being found liable because the users were anonymous, and it was impossible for the individual to seek compensation in bringing tort proceedings against the speakers themselves, this coming to the Strasbourg court, and the court dealing with the case, which I will tell you about in a moment. The second case, which is decided a few months later, is MTE versus Hungary. There, an intermediary had allowed users to comment on publications appearing on their portals. MTE was this sort of NGO, basically a non-governmental, non-profit organization dealing with internet service provider issues. It published an opinion criticizing the business practice of two real estate websites. Offensive comments were uploaded, and these parties were considered liable. The intermediaries were considered liable, like in Delfi. Now, dealing first with Delfi, the court looked to four elements in his assessment. First, the context of the comments. What was the overall context of the comments uploaded? Two, the potential liability of the comment authors, which is, of course, very difficult when you have users uploading anonymously or using a pseudonym. Third, the steps taken by Delfi to prevent or remove the comments. And fourth, the consequences of the domestic proceedings for Delfi. Delfi was the applicant, of course, within the court. The court held, the Grand Chamber of my court, held by a vote of 15-2, which is a rather substantial majority, that the finding of liability, that imposing liability on the internet service provider was justifiable under Article 10 of the Convention. In other words, Estonia was entitled to impose liability in this particular context. However, in the other case, the MTE case, the court found a violation. And I think that was for two reasons. Firstly, because in the MTE case, the nature of the comments were very different. They were just classic defamation. They were not hate speech. They were not violent speech. They were of a lower threshold of gravity. And therefore, the justification to impose liability on, remember, the third party, which is the disseminator or providing a platform, was considered to be non-justifiable. And secondly, in the Hungarian case, the national courts had not balanced these rights, the right of the intermediary to impart information via its website and the right to privacy of the injured person. And that balancing exercise needs to take place before the domestic courts. It cannot happen for the first time in the Strasbourg court. So let me then pose the question. What kind of liability regimes can we imagine? And what kind of liability regimes were considered or can be considered best appropriate in light of these judgments? And there are four different liability regimes that one can think of. The first is basically immunity on the internet. Neither the author, the actual user, nor the content provider is liable. The second, and the reason I mentioned this approach, is that there is to some extent a very open-ended freedom on this issue under U.S. law, for those of you that know U.S.-based internet regulations. The second approach is that only the user is liable, direct liability of the author. The third approach is the diametrical opposite, that the content provider is only liable. In other words, you shift the burden entirely on the content provider because of the dangers of the internet, which is, of course, very far-reaching. The fourth possibility is what can be called residual indirect liability. First, you ask, can liability be imposed on the speaker? If not, there can be a residual liability on the internet service provider in some exceptional circumstances. If you look at Delfi and MTE, I do believe that the court, as usual, says the best compatible form of liability is the speakers themselves. If the speakers can be held liable, that is, of course, the best way to guarantee the balance between Article 8 and Article 10, Article 8, the right to privacy. But when there have been unlawful comments of a grave nature, in those exceptional circumstances, you can perhaps impose liability on internet service providers. Now let me conclude then with some of the criticism leveled at Delfi, which have been quite substantial for many reasons. And I, of course, as a judge of the court, am not in a position to actively engage with academic commentators, but let me just make a couple of remarks. The first is that, as correctly noted in Magyar, the Grand Chamber in Delfi explicitly observed that if accompanied by effective procedures allowing for a rapid response, the notice and takedown system, if you know the EC Commerce Directive, the notice and takedown system under the EC Commerce Directive and its variations in domestic law, the court said that can function, and I quote, in many cases as an appropriate tool for balancing the rights and interests of all those involved. However, when, like in Delfi, the user comments take the form of hate speech and direct threats, the rights and interests of others and of society as a whole may entitle states to impose liability on internet news portals if they fail to take measures to remove such comments without delay, even without notice from the alleged victims or third parties. My second point would be that it may be argued that the court was in some sense encouraging states to consider the beneficial value of the notice and takedown system as a suitable mechanism for balancing these rights. However, states are not precluded from adopting more stringent forms of intermediary liability when confronted, as I mentioned, with the gravest forms of negative online comment. Let me then conclude with a reflection on sort of the two main threads of the case law as it is today. The first, and I know in other conferences that I've attended, academic and NGOs have not been very happy when I've said that I think one should realize that the Strasbourg court is composed of human beings, of people of flesh and blood, some of which are very hesitant to make grand pronouncements on the internet simply because we do not know where this mechanism is going. Especially many of my colleagues are in their 60s. Dealing with internet-related issues is not a very facile way of doing things. So remember that courts are people of flesh and blood, and they may want to tread cautiously in their first cases on this issue. So that's why I have said the Grand Chamber in Delfi, even though it's a Grand Chamber judgment, is not the basis or subject of very grand conclusions for the future. The second and last point is that, as I think the court adopted here, as I mentioned, a middle ground between the two opposing viewpoints, which I mentioned at the beginning, on the regulation of the internet. And I appreciate that this so-called middle ground approach may not satisfy those that argue that the internet should not be regulated at all, nor does it satisfy the opposing camp campaigning for robust online regulation, which may consider that intermediary liability should almost be the general rule. But I don't think it should come as a surprise that a court that has historically always attempted to find a middle ground between two human rights, which are hierarchically the same, the right to privacy and the freedom of expression, should in its first cases dealing with these very difficult issues on the internet, maintain its adherence to this kind of approach. And I don't believe we will see in the foreseeable future a substantial move away from the court attempting to secure the benefits of both rights. Thank you very much.
Thank you indeed for this very clear explanation what the cases were, what the problems were, what the court's decisions were. I think this is an excellent introduction into what will come, not least because of one of your last remarks, which I want to quote, that is what the court did was no basis for grand conclusions for the future, which is natural. It's also, I mean, you are basing your work on case law, so case by case, looking at the situation and judging again. Now, for in the whole sector and the industry, this is, of course, a bit unsatisfactory. You cannot wait until all the cases have accumulated, which can possibly give you all the ideas of how to deal with future cases. But luckily, we have CEIPI. And luckily, they take this challenge on and look at least in one particular aspect of this, which is geo-plotting, and try to look at it from all sides and to come up, I assume, with some sort of guidance, which may or may not be picked up by regulators or by the judiciary. In any event, it's my pleasure now to give the floor to Christophe Geiger and to the researcher at the CEIPI, Ms. Elena Izyumenko, and we'll see what they have done in order to further systemize the problems.
Thank you very much, Susanne. So just to make a little correction, it's website blocking, not geo-blocking, which is a different issue that we discussed with Ansip. But still, so the purpose of our talk today is actually to present a study that was just published in the American University International Law Review, which looks at internet service providers' involvement in the fight for enforcement, and what are the impacts that this involvement has on fundamental rights. And we have done this before the proposal of the copyright reform, which does not touch website blocking injunction in particular. So we did not discuss the copyright reform. We certainly will hear about it in the last panel discussion. But just a few words about this project. So this project is part of a bigger project that we have at the CEIPI since a couple of years, which look actually at the human rights implication that exists when you draft the contour, the shape, and the use of IP in court. And this particular paper is also meant to inform our policy work when it comes to enforcement of copyright in the digital environment. So why did we decide to tackle the issue from the angle of fundamental rights? Well, we heard it from Judge Spano. Of course, fundamental rights, human rights matter in the European Court on Human Rights, but they matter a lot also in the European Court of Justice. Now, I did not make a systematic study, but I would estimate that nowadays two-thirds of the decisions of the Court of Justice in the field of copyright is based on fundamental rights reasoning. So basically, whether you like it or not, you have to take into account these legal tools, and you have to understand their scope and their consequences when it comes to legal analysis. So, a couple of words about enforcement. So, the strategies that have been followed in the last couple of years by right holders have been various. There have been many attempts to address enforcement, many strategies. Actually, it seems that the industry sometimes concentrated on the enforcement strategies rather than on the business model. Because, of course, enforcing IP rights is very costly. So, of course, when you devote a lot of resources to enforcement, sometimes it might lag somewhere else. So, almost all players had to face legal actions. Users, of course, we've touched upon that. Maja had discussed this. This resulted in legislation such as Adopi, aiming at cutting the internet access of infringers. We had legal lawsuits against website operators. One of the famous website operators, of course, the Pirate Bay. As you know, there has been lots of litigation against the Pirate Bay, a very famous case also brought in front of the European Court of Human Rights on this. The problem is, whether you close one file sharing site in one country one day, the next day it opens in the next country. So that is also something that was not really what was hoped for. So then there was actions also against internet access providers of website operators. The problem is they're often very far in countries where you can have problems to basically get injunctions. And the last trend is now to tackle internet access providers of end users. So end users who do post content online. So the question, of course, now is to look at this in a very de-emotionalized way and looking at it from the perspective of EU law. So is this possible under EU law? So the problem is here, it's very difficult to understand what EU law means when it comes to website blocking injunction, and the legal situation is very unclear. We haven't got into the details so far with our first panel, but when you look at it a little bit closer, you know that from the InfoSoc Directive, Article 8.3, you can get an injunction against an intermediary whose service is used by a third party to infringe copyright. But the problem is that the conditions, the modalities of that are left back to national law and member states, so no harmonized approach here. We also know from the e-commerce directive that Article 12 and 14 provide for safe harbors for internet service providers. So they are not liable, that's quite clear, but that does not prevent to get a blocking injunction. That's also very clearly said in recital 45 of the same e-commerce directive. So we have a certain situation that it seems that a scholar, Martin Husovec, has put it like that. He said that ISPs are accountable but not liable. So it seems that they have to do something in order to prevent infringement, but what is quite unclear exactly what they have to do. So in the absence of clear indication by the legislators, of course, courts got a lot of lawsuits to deal with, and as you just heard from Judge Spano, some courts had to struggle very hard with such complex issues such as website blocking, because it's indeed quite a challenging task to decide on that based on very unclear law. And then, well, they have to use the tools that they have at hand, that is general principles such as fundamental rights and human rights. And they rightly that they have done so, because they have an obligation to do so according to the treaties which incorporate fundamental rights in primary legislation of the EU. That means the InfoSoc Directive, the Copyright Directive, have always to be read in the light of these fundamental rights in the Charter, but also according to Article 52 in the European Convention on Human Rights. So, what are the most important fundamental rights which are at stake when we talk about website blocking? Of course, intellectual property refers to property. That's Article 17.2 of the Charter and Article 1 of the Protocol, first Protocol of the European Convention on Human Rights. The European Court on Human Rights has stated many times that IP falls within that protection. Then it's freedom of expression, freedom to hold opinions, freedom to impart and receive information, and in particular on the internet. You might recall that the French Constitutional Court in 2009 said, based on freedom of expression, that there is a right to have access to the internet based on Article 10 of the European Convention. And then there is a rather mysterious right that we have in the Charter, which only exists in Europe, which is called the freedom to conduct business. It's not defined as such, and we do not have many court cases that really clearly define the scope of that right. but it seems to include the economic, technical, and financial resources available to economic operators. Now, of course, when you have to monitor the internet, you have to put people, you have to put resources behind it, so it affects the resources of the business in a general way. So what was the result? What does that mean? That means you have to, when you look at a specific situation, specific case of the website blocking injunction, at the EU Charter, the principle of proportionality between both rights, you have to, and to, you have to come up with a fair balance between all these various fundamental rights involved in the community legal order. That was very clearly put by the Court of Justice in the Komusiki decision. So this resulted in the case law of the European Court of Justice to two things. First, rather surprising, the court, faced with a strong enforcement claim, also decided that the other side might have also some rights. And we have seen in enforcement cases the emergence of what we call users' rights. And then if you put together the various decisions, and that's what we're going to do later on, you can see that there are some guidelines for website blocking that slowly are emerging. So one word about the users' rights. And that's quite interesting because it emerged in the context first of exceptions and limitation to copyright, and was developed further in a very important case that we will discuss later on. It's the Telekabel decision of the European Court of Justice. And what did the Court of Justice say in the context of website blocking? It said basically that national procedural rule must provide for the possibility of internet users to assert their rights before court. So that means not only right holders have rights, but also users have rights, and they must have the possibility to enforce it. That's quite innovative, and it seems to me, when I look at Article 13.2 of the proposal, that this logic of users' rights was taking over. Now, in order to speak about the case more in detail, I'm happy to head over to Elena.
Thanks, and hello once again, everyone. I will present now the recent case law of the European Courts on website blocking, and then sketch briefly some of the guidelines that we can extract from it. So the first case, the case from the EU Court of Justice, concerns a blocking order issued against a major Austrian internet access provider, UPC Telekabel, requiring it to block access of its customers to the website that was providing films for streaming and download without the right holder's consent. The crux of the case was that the order was directed against an ISP of end users, not infringing websites, and that it was result-oriented, something that is termed an outcome prohibition, which simply means that the courts don't specify the concrete means of achieving the blocking, the ISP just has to achieve it somehow. So the question was raised quite naturally before the Court of Justice, to which extent such an order was compatible with union law. In the CJ's opinion, it was compatible, but on condition that it reconciled the conflict in copyright, the ISP's freedom to conduct a business, and the internet user's freedom of information. With regards to the latter, the court held that the blocking had to be strictly targeted, and that the internet users had to be afforded an opportunity to assert their rights before national courts once the implementing measures taken by the ISP were known. As it concerns the ISP's freedom to conduct a business, there was no violation of this right either, insofar as an outcome prohibition left an ISP to choose which blocking measures better adapted to its resources to implement. It also allowed it to avoid liability by proving that it had taken all reasonable steps to comply with the order. Finally, as it concerns the right to property of copyright holders, the court held that the blocking had to be sufficiently effective to at least discourage certain users from accessing infringing content, which in practical terms meant that even the possibility of circumvention did not preclude the blocking. What is interesting, almost in the same time and without any coordination, another European court, the Court of Human Rights, had also issued its first decision on website blocking for copyright enforcement. The case concerned this time the blocking in Turkey of the website that was providing musical works in violation of copyright. The applicant that had applied to ZCHR as the user of the websites in question complained about the collateral effects of blocking that amounted, according to him, to a disproportionate response based on Article 10 of the European Convention on Human Rights that protects freedom of expression. So the question was raised this time only from the perspective of the user, as no provision analogous to the EU Charter's freedom to conduct a business exists in the European Convention on Human Rights. And what did the court say? It said, somewhat in contrast to the CJEU, that the so-called mere users did not have standing on the free speech grounds. It observed that the applicant was only indirectly affected by the blocking, that the blocking had as its aim the protection of copyright, and that many other alternative legitimate means of listening to music were available to the applicant. It was not also alleged that the blocked information was of a specific interest, and the blocking was moreover strictly targeted. Finally, the comparative importance of IP as a human right had also played its role here. So what we see from these cases is that the European courts advance from the perspective of different fundamental rights the guidelines on website blocking for copyright enforcement in Europe. So what are these guidelines first from the freedom of expression perspective? These are primarily the manner in which the website is used. Unlike the Court of Justice, the Strasbourg Court distinguishes between active users involved in not only receiving but also importing information on the internet and the so-called mere users acting as the passive recipients of such information. Other important factors include the collateral effects of blocking on legitimate content, the general public interest in the blocked information, and the availability of alternative means of accessing the blocked content. Now moving to the freedom to conduct a business guidelines for website blocking, which are once again only the EU-specific. The main factors here are the cost and complexity of blocking and subsidiarity, meaning whether the right holders need to try all other reasonable remedies first before going after non-liable intermediaries. Another important question is the own legitimacy of injuncting someone who is not even contributory liable. Finally, as it concerns the right to property guidelines for website blocking, both the comparative importance of IP as a human right and the proclaimed goal of enforcement all play their role here. But what is the most interesting is the level of efficacy that is required for the blocking. According to the CJEU, relative effectiveness is enough, meaning that the blocking is considered effective even when it doesn't prevent the infringement, but at least discourages certain users from accessing infringing content. What is left to be said here is that these guidelines are not always understood uniformly on the national level. One example is the collateral effects of blocking on legitimate content and the requirement that the blocking should be strictly targeted. On practical application, the question arises though how strict. Some quotes in the EU say that the blocking is fine even if it overblocks legitimate content, but only on condition that such content is insignificant in proportion to infringing. There are other courts, though, that rule on occasion that the blocking is disproportionate even when some legitimate content is affected. Another example is the link of injunctions to liability. What the CJEU basically said in Telekabel is that injuncting non-liable intermediaries is allowed in the EU, but it didn't say anything on whether it was also required. This is the ground on which Sweden, for example, now defends its Copyright Act, in accordance with which injunctions are allowed only in link with liability. These are, of course, only two examples, and there are much more. I will now give the floor back to Professor Geiger to draw some conclusions from this.
So very briefly, we see that we have guidelines by courts on the enforcement online. We have also guidelines on by courts on competing users' rights. What we also see is that courts still have a considerable room for discretion, and that's of course not very good for legal security. So many scholars have criticized actually the decision of the courts. I must say that listening to Judge Spano, I now realize how difficult the task is for maybe a 60-year-old judge to decide on the future of internet enforcement policy, specifically if he's a human rights person, because basically he's not even trained with the details of IP law or copyright, which is already very complex for our experts. So maybe this should be understood as an invitation for legislators to step in and do their work. We have a proposal on the table. We will see in the last panel discussion if this proposal is satisfying, and I look forward to this. Thank you.
Thank you to both of you for this very detailed and well thought through presentation. I just ensured myself that we can make this PowerPoint available on our website because it was very complex, and I expect immediately that we will be asked this anyway. In the same way, the conference is being filmed, as you can see and have had no doubts. So this will all be available to the wider public. This is the point where I will terminate my role as moderator and invite actually the panelists to come over. We will change seats a little bit, and it will now be in the hands of Christophe to moderate a discussion where we will look a little bit into the future after having taken so much and so thoroughly stock of the present. Thank you.
Thank you, Susanne. Happy to take over for this panel discussion, which, as you said, will look into the future. And to do that, we have a very rich panel. So without further ado, let me remind you of the rules of the panel. We do not have much time, okay? So it's 7 minutes for everyone, and I have to, speaking about enforcement, plead for very tough enforcement of this rule in that panel. So 7 minutes for you, and then we will have around 20 minutes to discuss with the audience. And depending on what would be the feedback with the audience, maybe react on each other presentation. But first, I'm very happy to give the floor to Julia Reda.
Thank you very much, Christophe, and thank you to CEIPI and also the Audiovisual Observatory for the invitation. I have the tough challenge to talk about the future of IP enforcement in mere 7 minutes. And because, of course, a lot of the discussion specifically on the review of the IPRED directive has not actually started yet, and there is not yet anything concrete from the European Commission, I decided to focus my intervention on a provision of the proposed copyright directive that, in my view, is actually an enforcement provision rather than a substantive copyright law, and that is the Article 13, that's also known as the value gap provision. I think I would like to say as a general remark that we are in a somewhat complex situation that is also seen from things like the discussions around the follow the money approach, that the copyright substantive law is so fragmented and so complex that copyright infringement, especially on the internet, is a very widespread phenomenon. And if it actually were perfectly enforced, we would probably also find ourselves in a very difficult situation, because there are a lot of activities that take place that may be in violation of the law, but nobody is actually very unhappy about that situation. But turning to the Article 13, this is a new provision that has been proposed, and Vice President Ansip has talked a little bit about the reasoning that particularly the music industry is unhappy about the difference of the licensing situation and license payments that they get from content providing platforms like Spotify on the one hand and intermediary platforms on the other hand, where users are uploading content. And so the Commission has made a proposal to address this, which I think from a fundamental rights perspective, but also simply from a perspective of having a coherent and simple to understand copyright system is posing quite a lot of challenges. You can see the proposal in its entirety on the slide, but the gist of it is, particularly of the first paragraph, that if an online platform provides public access to a lot of works that have been uploaded by users, that they either have to conduct licensing agreements with the rights holders and then make sure that these license agreements function, or they have to introduce some measures to prevent infringing works or the works of rights holders from becoming available in the first place. So we're not talking about notice and takedown here, but about preventing the availability. So this is rather a notice and stay down provision where a provider has to make sure that this content never shows up. There are some novel concepts here. If you're looking at it from a copyright perspective, you may wonder what providing public access exactly means, because there is some level of disagreement about whether an online intermediary where users are uploading content is actually engaged in an act of communication to the public in the first place, or whether it isn't rather the users who are uploading the content who are performing the copyright relevant act and who may be in conflict with copyright law. Then there's the question of the relationship with the e-commerce directive. If an internet service provider is actually engaging in a copyright-relevant act, or if they're indirectly liable, do they fall under the safe harbor of the e-commerce directive? So a lot of questions are raised here. And I think from a fundamental rights perspective and also from a perspective of exercising the exceptions and limitations to copyright, this proposal leaves a lot to be desired. First of all, it talks about a very vague concept of online platforms. So this provision is supposed to apply to those platforms that host a large amount of user-uploaded content. Of course, there's probably going to be different interpretation of national legislators what exactly constitutes a large amount. But aside from that, it doesn't actually talk about infringing content. So this means that if we were to take this literally, a platform where users upload a lot of content legally, such as Wikipedia, for example, where a lot of the content is provided under a CC license by the rights holders, would have to comply with this provision. So this would mean, for example, that Wikipedia would have to engage in negotiating license agreements with rights holders, which doesn't really make sense because the rights holders have put their content under a CC license. Or in the absence of that, put in place measures to prevent the availability of works that might be infringing. Well, first of all, I haven't heard a lot of complaints about a lot of copyright infringement works being uploaded to such a platform. And secondly, there's also no limitation about exactly which kinds of works this would apply to. I mean, it's quite clear that the Commission had musical works in mind, and one particular platform, namely YouTube. But ironically, YouTube is probably the only platform that may already be complying with this provision, because they already have in place this content recognition technology that is at least able to prevent the availability of rights holders' work. But I don't see how essentially a grievance with one particular platform can be solved by imposing the measures that that platform has already taken on all of their competitors and on everybody else in the market. The question of copyright exceptions, I think, is a quite complex one, because this article does not say that a platform has to prevent the availability of infringing works, but rather of any instances of these protected works becoming available. One would have to assume that this would also be the case if the use of that work is actually covered by an exception, which would raise the question mentioned by Professor Geiger, whether the users actually have some sort of right to make use of their exceptions and how that would be interpreted by the court. I don't share the interpretation that the second paragraph of Article 13 would solve this problem, simply by referring to complaint and redress mechanisms for the users. I do think there are a lot of wrongful takedowns, and having a redress mechanism in place is probably a good idea. But at the same time, the redress mechanisms would be done not on the basis of the law, but on the basis of the terms and service of a platform. And of course, a platform might be able to write into their terms of service that they only accept licensed content, and therefore the exception defense wouldn't really be applicable. Finally, there's the question of the compatibility with the e-commerce directive. If we're saying that some host providers, and it's specified in the recitals that this applies regardless of whether they actually fall under the safe harbor or not, have to put in place this content recognition technology, how does this harm, or how can this be reconciled with the ban on general monitoring obligations under the e-commerce directive, if you're supposed to not just remove infringing content, but to prevent the availability of content by certain rights holders? Clearly, you have to look for this content as it is being uploaded, hence you have to monitor everything that is being uploaded. So I think this proposal and this article will cause a lot of headaches, not just for lawyers, but also for policymakers, who will have to think about, okay, how can a provision like this function? How can it actually end up contributing to the digital single market and not end up being interpreted and implemented in a very different way by 28 different national legislators? I will leave it at that, and I think we will be having this discussion for many months to come. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Julian. So we're discussing actually legal clarity. It seems that at least from Article 13, there are still some shadows that will have to be understood later on. So I'm very happy to actually give the floor to my next panelist, Mr. Rudi Grosso. Please.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen. It's a great pleasure for me to be here and to speak about the work that my committee has done, which I serve as secretary, and of course about the work that Mr. Axel Fischer, the parliamentarian and rapporteur on this subject, has submitted to the committee, which was then adopted in the resolution by the Parliamentary Assembly, which is available for you. Copyright is not a new issue. Since 1770, the English Statute of Anne, actually as the first copyright law, set down copyright protection. The Berne Convention is from 1886. And in 1949, the Parliamentary Assembly of the Council of Europe, at its first session, debated a report by the French MP, Mr. Longchambon, who called for the creation of a European patent protection system. So why do we still discuss today copyright or intellectual property rights in general? The answer is, of course, it seems that the internet has to change the world. And I'm glad to say that I'm not yet 60 years old, because we've heard earlier that people 60 years old or older I'm maybe not able to understand the internet and statement and the judgment which I would not want to share. Well, how has the world changed? First, copying and distributing are obviously easier online. In addition, there's perceived anonymity online, which we all know is of course not true, because on the internet everybody knows that you're a dog. Thirdly, the jurisdiction question seems to be more difficult, at least from a legal perspective. Secondly, intellectual property-related industries produce €509 billion per year for the European Union. So it's a huge economic impact and a huge economic factor for our industries, but also for our culture, for our cultural industries, as the committee has stated. We have seen this also that several countries have sought to attract internet industries, either through tax privileges. Iceland some years back said that it would be the freest country in Europe regarding media freedom, which is a very interesting statement, because how can you be more freer than free? Anyway, so there's a huge run after this economic impact. And thirdly, of course, content is king. especially for the new internet industries that have based their business models on either user-generated content or file sharing of content of third parties, which is mostly copyright protected. With that background, then it's quite clear that there's a lot of discussion because there's a lot of money involved and a lot of interest. That seems to also convolute the discussion at times. As we have seen, for instance, in some prominent abuse cases, the Pirate Bay case of the European Court of Human Rights in 2013, which was mentioned by Judge Spano, where the court clearly stated that obviously the prosecution of the owners of Pirate Bay in Sweden did not violate the European Convention on Human Rights. Another case one could refer to is that of Kim Schmitz, alias Kim.com, Finnish German national living in New Zealand, who has made hundreds of millions, or at least I think some 200 million euros or US dollars, which had been seized through a file sharing website, and also financed, for instance, the Internet Party in Australia. And I think that also is quite interesting to see how that huge amount of money also seems to influence policy making. What is the reaction by the internet industry? For our part of the world, the internet industry is mostly, of course, regulated by the Digital Millennium Copyright Act of the United States of 1998. And therefore, Google, for instance, has set up a mechanism and receives 22 million demands per week for deleting research results to copyright infringement websites. YouTube has set up already several years back a copyright school. If you download copyright protected material, then you will be directed to that copyright school. You have to listen to why copyright is important. But YouTube also offers targeted advertising through a program called Content ID. So if you're a copyright owner, you can actually buy that advertising possibility and have them to the one who violates your copyright and advertising sent to them. And Facebook also provides mechanism for indicating copyright violations. If that is the case, well, where is Europe? Because the Digital Millennium Copyright Act, of course, doesn't apply in Europe unless you have these big multinational players with a seat in the United States. As it was mentioned several times, for the Council of Europe, Article 1 of the first protocol to the European Convention on Human Rights clearly states that intellectual property rights is a fundamental human right. And the same is also true for the EU Charter of Fundamental Rights, Article 17.2, which, interestingly enough, might not apply to all member states, as we know that there are at least two cases with reservations, but it for sure binds all organs of the European Union. So also the Parliament and the Commission. What has the Parliamentary Assembly recommended in its resolution, which I've distributed? I just want to focus on a few points which the Assembly has adopted. And that is, at first, that geographical location and geo-blocking is possible offline and online. This makes sense. Because if you're the owner of a copyright-protected work, you may want to use it online as well as offline. And if you have then different contracts, and of course it doesn't work if offline it's suddenly everywhere. Europe-wide licensing arrangements should be used for cross-border portability of content. That is a huge issue, which is also discussed at the EU level. And there the committee found that actually a solution which has also been found in the United States, as there the interstate commerce is also possible here through Europe-wide licensing. Then a third issue, users are of course rights holders of their own content, like as they are the owners of their own data. So therefore user empowerment should actually then record that to users, and with electronic copyright identification tools for digital content, users should be empowered actually to indicate their copyright if they so want. Then, fourthly, ISPs can possibly help liable for copyright violations. That we have heard already here from the Court of Human Rights. And following from the Cybercrime Convention of the Council of Europe, as well as other international treaties and national laws, copyright violations should be punished by law, which is something normal, as I said, for many years in the offline world. And it's difficult to understand why it should be different online. The industry has also responded to it in 2017 by setting up principles for user-generated content services, voluntary self-regulatory principles, which so far haven't been recognized very much. It's important to actually recognize that industry action. And I would like to close my intervention by referring to paragraph 5, because we've heard before that the Court of Human Rights supposedly wasn't sure whether the internet would be something separate, immune, or whether it would be actually something which could be regulated. And the Assembly clearly stated that digital services do not take place in an imaginary borderless cloud, but they are real services with real producers, real distributors, and real customers, all of which are based in real countries. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Dussel. The idea of this roundtable was actually to put together all the different forces that think about copyright and copyright framework in Strasbourg. So, we've heard from the European Parliament, we've heard from the Council of Europe, and now we've heard from our center, from CEIPI. And I'm very happy to give the floor to Giancarlo for the presentation.
Thank you very much. And let me stress, it's such a great pleasure for me too to be here and talk about this issue in a moment in which we are really thinking about how to change and adapt our system to new challenges. And we are discussing a reform that we've been waiting for several years, probably 15, maybe more. So this is a very delicate time. I have my blueprint in front of me, but now what I will say will work very much as a reaction to what Justice Spano has said, to what Ms. Reda has said, and what earlier Mr. Svoboda has mentioned. I will move from the general, the more general, to the particular, and then again to the general, and so please bear with me, it should make sense in the end. And I will start with a side. Now, in enforcing a strict liability regime for alleged copyright infringement, most likely was parody, occurring on YouTube, Justice Solomon from the Superior Court of Brazil, some sort of Corte de Cassación in Brazil, something in the middle between Corte de Cassación and the Supreme Court in Brazil, stated that if Google created an untamable monster, it should be the only one charged with any disastrous consequences generated by the lack of control of the users of its websites. Now, this statement might echo something that Judge Spano mentioned a few minutes ago. And actually, I had the citation here, and I intended to recite it, and then Justice Spano anticipated me in Delfi section 110. Justice Spano is talking about a defamatory, the decision is talking about defamatory or types of unlawful speech that can be disseminated like never before worldwide. And this is echoing again old case in the United States where Justice Newman in Universal versus Corley in discussing whether the MCA should be applied to, should be used as an instrument for censorship online, says that here dissemination itself carries a very substantial risk of imminent harm because the mechanism is so unusual by which dissemination of means of circumventing access control to copyrighted works threatens to produce virtually unstoppable infringement of copyright. This is what I call the digital threat discourse. And I want to start here to set a little bit the framework of what we are discussing. It's a tough matter to balance. There is what has been dominating our discourse, the narrative so far, is very much this digital threat discourse. consider, and I will come back to this in a few minutes, that there is also a digital opportunity discourse that could be taken into consideration. Now, Justice Solomon, in order to tackle, to tame the untamable monster, decided to impose a monitoring obligation on YouTube. Monitoring obligation, practically monitoring as exactly what we are talking when we're talking about Article 13. And I'm trying to frame this discussion within a global frame and trying to identify a trend here. Now, this decision from Justice Solomon, the case called DAFRA, and the case regarded actually users uploading on YouTube synchronized videos of a commercial from this motorcycle company called DAFRA, and the user was actually mocking the company, making a tarnishing statement because he considered that the DAFRA motorcycle weren't as good as they were advertised. Now, this is not definitely an isolated case. This emergence of courts imposing monetary obligation. We have a very large number of recent case law imposing a monetary obligation on intermediaries. In the copyright domain, with Allo streaming in France, asking Google and Bing and all search engines to delist a number of websites proactively that could infringe copyright in movies. The rapid share cases in Germany, in which we have monetary obligation imposed on platforms like RabbitShare because there is a presumption in that platform infringement could happen more easily. Or again, the Baidu case in China, decided by the court of Beijing, in which there is an interesting mechanism in which rapid monitoring is triggered by the popularity of the works. So as soon as the work becomes very popular on the platform, you should rapidly monitor. Now, there are exceptions in this context. For the landmark case of Berlin in Argentina, in which we were dealing with personality rights, substantially a number of TV stars for many years asked search engines to expunge the internet from content that was tarnishing their personality rights. The Supreme Court in Argentina went the opposite direction and said that no monetary obligation was ever allowed. Now, as you see, we're not only talking about copyright protection. Narrative, this emergence of proactive monitoring, spans all the broader spectrum of intermediary liability issues. So from intellectual property, privacy, defamation, hate and dangerous speech. And I imply that, as we've seen, because Justice Spano mentioned the Delfi case, and in which proactive monitoring was applied, and he mentioned the fact that there was a concerning issue there, so I won't develop that any further. He mentioned that proactive monitoring was applied to Delfi. And then we have in private a number of privacy cases in Europe related to the so-called Max Mosley saga. Remember, Max Mosley was the president of the Formula One, and then he was caught engaging in two sexual acts with prostitutes, and he was set up actually by a UK newspaper, and then all the videos and the pictures leaked. And after suing the newspaper and being found that was a feature of his privacy, then he sued search engines so that the internet could be expunged by any of these pictures. And actually courts in France, in the UK, and Germany imposed monitoring obligations, so proactive monitoring, has been already said, but the traditional way by Justice Panel, the traditional way in which takedown works in the internet is upon actual or constructive knowledge. Constructive knowledge happens through notice, and takedown, actual knowledge happened to so-called the red flags, to presumption that this content is infringing. So, proactive monitoring applied to all the spectrum of possible intermediary liability subject. Now, legislation proposals have been followed suit, and we've seen, and I won't develop any longer on that, we've seen that the digital single market strategy would like to introduce a filtering obligation for intermediaries to close the value gap. And here I go back to what I was mentioning a minute ago about the value gap. what I was mentioning before about digital threat discourse. This discourse about value gap is very much a digital threat discourse. On the opposite side, we could have also an added value. Now, I'm suggesting so that we're witnessing right now, and I will conclude, that we're witnessing right now a trend in at what I can call the death of no monitoring obligation. A well-marked trend in intermediary liability policy, and so that our internet policy and copyright policy is suddenly shifting away from a fundamental safeguard, both for freedom of expression online and also for in terms of innovation policy, because no filtering obligation means also removing barriers to innovation. And this is connected also to an additional number of policies that are there. EU non-state down regime globally, and perhaps also voluntary measures that should be enforced very soon. And I will stop here because I think I have too much of the time at my disposal.
Thank you, John. Our next speaker is, where is she? Here is it. Silvia Gundmann. I'm going to come back to the Council of Europe. Please, yeah.
Thank you, Professor Geiger. When Professor Geiger asked us panelists to tell us, or tell you here, what we would like to see in the future for copyright enforcement, I thought, okay, coming in from an international perspective, as I work for a pan-European human rights organization, I should, of course, share my human rights perspective on that. And that is, I would like to see a cultural paradox resolved. What do I mean by that? The internet is and has a culture where access to information is for free. Now, legacy or traditional media has a culture where we accept that we pay for journalism to ensure good quality. We buy newspapers, if we still buy newspapers, so we are used to paying for that content. And we all know that quality journalism is expensive. In particular, when you look into investigative journalism, it's highly costly. And it's highly necessary to lay open threats to our democracies. For instance, when it comes to corruption. You all know examples of this in any given country. So, we also agree that we want a marketplace of ideas. So we want to have media diversity. We want to have media pluralism. And yet, when it comes to the internet, nobody, and I include myself, wants to pay for content online. How much do I click on content where I have to pay for? Ask yourselves, what is your policy there? So that is for me a dilemma. We all have to reflect on that. And at the Council of Europe, we are reflecting and we are trying to find solutions to bring us into the discussion and to give indeed guidance to our 47 member states how to deal with these very complex issues from a human rights perspective. How are we doing this? We have a steering committee in place. The 47 member states plus observers and participants take part in a dialogue and they work on policy guidance. That is a cumbersome dialogue. It will take time. Concretely, we work now with the help of a subordinate expert committee on internet standard setting for intermediaries. So we look into the roles and responsibilities of internet intermediaries. You have heard Judge Spano mapping out the Delfi case, mapping out the MTE versus Hungary case. More cases will come from the court. And of course, we base this recommendation in a critical manner on the court's case law. You will see the product in about 1 year's time. You can see then a draft proposal, and it then has to go to our main stakeholders, the Committee of Ministers at the Council of Europe. We'll do something else. We also work on a recommendation on media pluralism and transparency of media ownership. Now there, we will do something new in the sense that we will put in a part on media and information literacy. And you have heard Maja Cappello at the beginning of this conference stressing how important media literacy, and I say that in the broadest sense, encompassing knowledge how to use information that's on the internet, no matter where this information comes from. I consider this media literacy extremely important for all of us, notably to prevent developments as we have seen them recently in the context of the US elections. Now, I mentioned we have heard here this value gap discussion, and I mentioned the need for quality journalism costing money, and how can then traditional media generate money, what is the role of platforms, etc. We will engage in a dialogue there with stakeholders and the CDMSI in a workshop that will take place next Thursday. It will be a closed workshop, so not open to the public, but the conclusions of this workshop we will then put into the public domain. The topic of it is the future of news, media, and journalism in the age of digital convergence. So you see, the copyright issue will certainly come up there. And once we have embarked, it's the very first step of such a discussion, but we will see how to move the topic further. I would also like to share with you that we have come up with a comparative study on blocking, filtering, and taking down of illegal internet content. That was done with the help of the Comparative Law Institute in Lausanne, Switzerland. And you can see this product on our website, and it's extremely valuable because you have there information of all 47 Council of Europe member states. So you get an idea also on what the practice is as to copyright enforcement. So should you be interested, please visit our website. Now, I'm aware that most requests for takedown of content is in relation to alleged copyright violations. And that is an issue because it can result in lengthy and costly judicial proceedings, and it can also be to the detriment of the company, the startup, whatever, going belly up. So, being bankrupt then. Now, my hope for the EU proposal is that it can contribute to more clarity, so more legal safety there, preventing such costly judicial proceedings, which are not in the interest of anybody, probably of those who have very deep pockets and can afford it. And, well, as to the value gap, I'm not sure whether that provision will really prevent an exodus of more traditional media. Probably the traditional media landscape most likely will further change. We might also have to get accustomed to that. However, we must ensure equal access to information and good quality information, because that is what we all need to preserve our democracy. Otherwise, a good quality dialogue will not be possible. Thank you.
Thank you very much. You see how interesting this panel is, because one of the aims was, of course, to tackle the issue of copyright enforcement from different institutions, and we've done that, but also from different legal regimes. We have heard from copyright law, we have heard from e-commerce, we should not forget media law, information law, human rights law. All this is basically the framework of our democratic information society, and this perspective is very precious because it's actually actually helps us to open our mind to the entire complexity in the society issues that are at stake. And talking about different perspectives, we have not heard that much about the perspective of authors so far, so I'm very happy to give the floor to Cécile Bittner.
Thank you very much, and it's an honor for being among such a distinguished panel of academics, experts, and politicians. And as you said, I think it's interesting to hear the view of what we call in general the rights holders, but more specifically the views of authors. So just to introduce myself, I'm the executive director of the Society of Audiovisual Authors. It's an European organization grouping collective management organizations managing rights for screenwriters and directors in Europe. So of course I was very pleased to hear Vice President Ansip saying that the big problem with piracy is that authors are not remunerated. I would say that it's going beyond authors, it's the whole industry, and I'm talking more about the audiovisual industry, that is not getting any remuneration for when works are pirated. So this is a huge problem in Europe, but not only. A huge problem for the European audiovisual industry, because as Maja presented it very cleverly, the growth of an industry is based on trust and confidence, if I remember well. So it's a big handicap for the European audiovisual industry to have such a piracy in Europe. But it's for us, it's going beyond the traditional, of course, media and distributors of audiovisual works. It's also it's preventing the development of the online content market in Europe. So I think this is not a very specific or a selfish concern of the audiovisual industry. It's a problem for Europe in general. In this context, we need efficient action against piracy, and it requires a multifaceted approach. It requires strong political, legislative, and judicial messages, and momentum, I would say, at EU level for this battle to be won. We have a problem with the articulation of copyright rules and the e-commerce directive. I mean, it's a problem for having really strong action against piracy. The full model is based on action from rights holders. Okay, it's their rights, so they have to defend them, but all the burden of the action is on rights holders' shoulder, with the notice and takedown measures, with legal actions. You know that legal actions are very costly. And remember that the European audiovisual industry, if we focus on cinema, for example, is not a big industry of big companies or big studios. The industry is made mainly of small production companies, who do not have the time, the resources to monitor the web and to look for the catalog of films they have produced and look for infringing activities. So this is a very unfair situation, that the whole burden is really on rights holders to defend their rights and to take legal actions, to notice for taking down audiovisual works, infringing uploads that will reappear the next minute. So this is really a tough job that is on this industry, and they can't do this job on their own. That's why there is a need for the society in general to share this burden, and for the state and the institution to enter into this necessity for respecting a human right, respect for intellectual property. So this is something I think that needs to a renewed message of institutions to fight piracy is really of the utmost importance. Of course, in this context, we welcome the initiative of the European Commission on follow the money, because it's not, I mean, piracy is not an issue. I mean, it's a multifaceted problem, but we know the link with illegal activities in general, and focusing on commercial scale infringement is interesting through advertising and online payment actors. So these memorandum of understanding that are discussed with the operators in this film would be very helpful to drain illegal websites of their economic resources. This is very welcome. But it's it's not enough. I think, as I said, more should be done. Of course, there is the enforcement directive that will be reviewed. But here we are very much into the legal action, so going to court, what kind of injunctions you can get. And as I just said, it's the ultimate pass for rights holders, in particular. European production companies in the audiovisual sector. It's the last step to take. So I would like to insist on raising awareness, which was also touched upon into the discussion. I think it's part of the momentum we need. We all know many people who do not have who are not aware that they are infringing intellectual property rights, or do not care about it. I think copyright awareness is really a must. We know that as soon as you raise the lack of remuneration of authors, it's something that touch people more than just saying, well, it's bad. You should not do that. So we are, I think most of the authors are ready to participate in this, but it can't be there only on their shoulder. It should be something really initiated by the institutions and promoted by the institutions. So media literacy should be involved, of course. But it's a more general problem linked to the internet. I think it was raised also a strong problem that many people don't want to pay for anything online. So this is something maybe larger than copyright. In conclusion, I just want to say a few words on the copyright package that the Commission just presented. I think we, coming back to authors should be remunerated, this is something that we welcome the Commission proposed directive, but which is a first step into a fair remuneration to authors, but we need that stronger proposal should be included, so that to really ensure that in the online world, authors get their fair share of the exploitation of their works. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So now we turning to our last speaker that will provide us probably with some perspective from the other side of the ocean, right?
Hopefully. Thank you. I'm really happy to be here, and I thank CEIPI and Observatory, particularly CEIPI2, because they very generously hosted me. And I'm attempting to get a book done this year that has been a long-standing project, and so I'm on my sabbatical from my home school. And so they have both brought me into activities when I wanted to be involved and left me alone when I'm trying to write. So it's been an incredible situation. My background's a little unusual in that I was a full-time singer-songwriter for 12 years and went to law school only when I was 30 years old, so a little bit of a late bloomer. And then I've also, as a lawyer, have represented startups and content producers. So I've kind of seen both sides of the fence, and as an academic, I try to look at both those sides. What I thought I might do, hopefully usefully for you today, is to just talk about two issues under the DMCA that are relevant to this issue of enforcement. And one is the safe harbor, because it's really the safe harbor under the DMCA that drives the notice and takedown craziness that I'll talk about in a moment. And the second is to talk about YouTube's content ID and this notion about whether and how we can have internet service providers engaging in some ways helping the content providers to monitor activity and to monetize or keep stuff off the internet. Okay, so the safe harbor first. The safe harbor is something that, for those who are not familiar with that term or how we do it in US law, is a somewhat unusual statutory provision. It happens, we have them in securities law and some other areas, but it means that there was an area of case law that was so gray and disputed that it was costing lots of money for the parties, and no one could quite determine whether their actions would turn out to be lawful or unlawful. So then Congress will put in a so-called safe harbor, or sometimes a federal agency has the power to put a safe harbor in. What does that mean? Well, it means that you have a checklist of things you do, and so long as you do those things, you then are immune from, or you're held to not have violated the law. So why did we put a safe harbor in the DMCA? Well, initially the concern was about internet access providers, rather than today thinking about internet service providers and sort of online businesses. Instead, we wanted to ensure that people could get on the internet at all. And those telecom companies and the original walled garden models of CompuServe and America Online were rightly concerned that if they gave free, not free cost, but if they gave open access, available access to everyone, they would suddenly be liable for everything that went on. And so just like we had exempted the telephone company and others who carry communications from liability of those communications, it made sense to do that. But we were not entirely clear in the way the statute was written, and it then was covering lots of online businesses too. Okay, so that's the root of the safe harbor. And one of the main checkpoints on the safe harbor is that you have to then engage in the notice and takedown. So you have to register with the Copyright Office, your DMC agent, and if you do that and you accept, you give an address where you can receive notices, and then you promptly take down and go through the procedure, you're then immune from liability. Okay? So it's a great system on one level. But the problem is that it spawned a lot of unintended consequences. And one is the thing that parties on both sides call the DMCA license. And what they mean by that is, okay, since there is the safe harbor, an online service provider that accepts user-generated content, because that's what this is really about, user-generated content being posted. And now that person, the company who's letting the stuff be posted on their site is the intermediary. That user-generated content now is subject to the notice and takedown. And so the problem then has become that the online service provider says, well, as long as I comply with notice and takedown, then I don't have to worry about having liability for any of this. So if lots of my users put on infringing material, I have essentially a license for that material. Does that make sense? So that's what I mean by this idea of the DMCA license. Now, it's been really helpful in some ways because it's allowed a lot of tech companies to explore business models that otherwise might have put them out of business with potential liability. But it's also cost content providers because now a lot of their stuff is being put online. Okay, so on the other side of this, so we have on the one hand massive kind of piracy going on hidden behind the so-called DMCA license. The content provider puts in their notice, the content gets taken down, but then it gets reposted. So that's on one side. But there's abuse on the other side that you have probably heard about, which is people issuing kind of false takedown notices. Maybe they're not the copyright owner at all, or they are, but they just want to harass somebody. So we're seeing abuse on both sides of this But everyone is desperately trying to stay within the DMCA safe harbor so that they have this immunity from liability. So let me give one proposal that I've been floating in the US to the Copyright Office and to also, I was testifying in Congress a couple of years on notice and takedown. And one of the ideas would be that with the new technologies, things like blockchain and other ways, other digital rights management and copyright management information that can be embedded into the content, that you could then change the safe harbor to say you only maintain the safe harbor if you only accept, or you only have the safe harbor for the content you accept that has that digital rights management information still in it. Why am I saying this? Well, because one of the biggest problems with the piracy side is content is having that meta information stripped out of it. And so no one can really quite track what's going on there. Now, you might say, well, that seems disastrous because now you're going to restrict free speech, fair use for people to then be able to put on things. But the issue is that the safe harbor is somewhat unusual in the first place. So any internet service provider already cannot use the safe harbor and just say, I'm not going to follow notice and takedown. And it just puts them back into the way the world was before the DMCA. So you can still have, a company can just say, we're not going to worry about that. And so we're not going to accept only digital rights management protected information. We're going to accept anything, and then we'll have to see you in court if a problem arises. Okay, so that's one sort of controversial thing. Hopefully that woke everyone up, and we'll have a robust discussion. The second issue is with Content ID. You may have heard Google will say, first, that it's a pretty good system. It doesn't capture all the seems to be infringing activity, but it captures a lot of it. But their concern is they say, look, we spent, I think someone earlier quoted $60 million creating this, so we don't want to give it away for free, obviously. And smaller startups that are worried about a regime in which they might have to use something like Content ID say, well, I can't afford to invest $60 million and create this. But we have, and again, this is editorializing, hopefully waking up everyone up, we have a system for this, especially in the technology area of standard essential patents. What do I mean by that? Well, we have a system where we say, look, if you have a technology that's critical to a certain industry or a platform, then you have to agree to license it on FRAND terms, fair, reasonable, and non-discriminatory terms. So Google and others who have things like Content ID can make money off it. They should be able to, but they also have to make it available. That then can really solve this problem of folks who then say, I can't develop that software on my own, but they can use it and have it available. Okay, last point I want to make is just that as we're looking at all this, and it was an excellent discussion of news and what's going to be the costliness of having good news services out there. Some of you may have been tracking, I've just been following it today, the fake news issue going on in the US election and the aftermath, and particularly Pizzagate that apparently has just unfolded, where an unfortunate guy who runs a pizza shop in Washington, D.C. had a bunch of fake news stories identifying his pizza shop as, wait for it, as a place of child trafficking run by Hillary Clinton and John Podesta. So, I mean, it might be true. I'm thinking it's not true, but I'm assuming it's not true, Dan. So, but this poor, it sounds funny, but this poor guy now has been inundated with hate mail and people coming there and threatening him, and he's trying to get this information taken off Twitter and things like that. So these are very real issues. And what we're seeing with a lot of this then is how do we then create a robust digital ecosystem that does preserve and protect the rights of content producers, allows people to make enough money so we can have good news, news sites that can do investigative reporting, and at the same time can still allow tech innovators to come up with new business models. Thank you.
Thank you. For giving us the broad perspective. So it's always like, you know, I was starting with this panel with enforcement. I set the rule, 7 minutes each. I say I will enforce it, and everyone took 9 minutes, right? So despite my injunctions, which were totally fruitless, In a way, that just to cut a little bit of our discussion time, actually cut most of our discussion time, so we actually gonna be able to take one or two questions, but not many more. And you have to leave because you have an appointment. Thank you very much for taking part in this.
Hello, I'm Pauline Durandian from the Federation of European Film and TV Directors. It's not exactly a question, more a general remark. It feels like the discussions today were interesting and thought-provoking, but they also feel a little out of touch with the daily life reality of some operators out there, particularly in the cultural sector. Of course, it's very exciting to discuss the future and the evolution of legislation in the copyright field, but I think, and thank you, Mrs. Goodman, for your perspective, which was really political, I think, on our issues. This is not only about disrupting business models, this is not only about scarcity of revenue, this is about the daily life of people working in the cultural sectors. And of course, the entertainment industry is also concerned, but for us here in Europe, we value the idea that we have national audiovisual policies supporting our sectors. And I'm afraid that we cannot afford to be dogmatic in our vision of the future and our vision of the future of copyright in particular, because this is the basis on which not only our industry, but also our creative minds operate. And I have to say, listening to hours of discussions of this sort in different settings, at some point we need a political vision for this also at European level, not only at national level. And this cannot be the only perspective Europe has to offer, that to remunerate creators you have to fight piracy with zero concrete proposals. And as much as I understood from today, maybe I'm mistaken, but despite soft law I didn't hear much. So, you know, maybe I'm overreacting, but at some point there is a need to sober up from the excitement of the future and remember we're talking about real lives, real labor markets, real creation and the future of what we hold here in Europe in terms of cultural policies. So this is just food for thought for the future. Excitement is great. Sobering up sometimes can be also a little bit useful. And we hope that we can do something with the current proposals that we have on the table for the copyright legislation reform at EU level. But we need further thinking on this. This is not enough. This needs to be much more ambitious. And you know, the future is demanding. Let's be demanding as well of ourselves and what we see for what's next.
Thank you. Well, thank you very much. Actually, an extension of our panel to the right. Well, thank you for this. It's more a statement than a question. So I'll pass over if there is any further. Doesn't seem so. So, okay. So I'm happy to actually say thank you to all the panelists. And thank you also for the audience. So we had a full house today. So that means that at least even if we provide for a fruitless discussion, it generates some interest somehow.